We are not alone. We are never alone. God is always with us. We are not alone.
We are not. morning, church. I hope that you've had some lovely moments in your week with all this sunshine, this warmth. It's almost been a little bit too hot a few times there. We had a church council meeting on Wednesday over Zoom, and together we made a decision to prioritize live streaming worship now and for the future, even when we are back in the building together. Many of you, actually about 75 of you, indicated that it was very important to you on the survey that we sent out that we continue to do that live streaming. And we have found as well that a significant number of people are finding our congregation to be a life-giving source of connection. We don't want to put a stop to that. And so I'm assuming that if you found this video, that you probably have made it to YouTube, so that's a good thing. But we're going to show a short clip just in case you haven't been able to figure out how to find the comments yet, okay? So go ahead and say anything you want in there. Just know that we can't like each other's comments anymore, so that's a little different. But we're trying to figure out the benefits of using this. So watch this.
If you found us today, then that's a great thing. If you're still struggling a little bit, you can go to our website, which is GHUMC.org. And this screen should come up for you. The picture changes, but you'll see this. Now watch my cursor down here. Right now it says test 719, but later it would say the actual today's worship link. And then you're just going to press on that there, that link. And it will take you to our live service that's happening right now. Okay? And so this is the service right here. You're not hearing anything right now because we have the music turned off so that you can hear me. But if you want to find the live chat area, follow my cursor and you go to the right. And for me right now, it says my name. But if I want to write something, I just put my cursor there and say, hello, everyone. And when I press return, it moves up the page. So some of you might actually have to move up and down to get there. We'll see what happens. I can't do that right now, but that's how we find it. If you're struggling with this today, feel free to send us an email. I can't say that we'll answer those emails during worship, but we will definitely check them over this afternoon and tomorrow and try to answer all your questions. Thanks for watching.
Thank you. This has been a really full week of ministry. And I know that many of you had some very painful moments as well as some incredible times of joy. I have to tell you that I am so proud to be the pastor of a church where people care about one another, where we reach out to each other in really hard times by whatever means that we can. And right now, all of those means aren't the same as they usually are. You know, Pastor Al and I can only do so much, but our congregation together can do far more. So thank you for loving each other well. Thank you for looking for ways to care. You are making a difference in each other's lives. So let's see what the Nielsen family has for us today as they talk about how their plans have changed. Here we go.
In Jeremiah 29:11, it says, "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They are plans for good and not for a disaster, to give you a future and a hope."
God's plans are sometimes surprising. How have your plans changed, even this summer?
We were going to go hiking in Scotland and visit friends in Germany, but because of COVID, we decided to stay close to home and went hiking in the Olympics with llamas.
And how did that go?
Not quite according to plan, but it was still awesome.
What plans changed?
A lot of the trail hadn't been cleared yet, so we couldn't go as far as we thought.
There are places that even llamas cannot go.
But we got to spend more time with the llamas.
So, how would you rate your trip, even with the plans changing again and again?
I think it was still pretty awesome.
Really
fun. Yeah, it was fun. We got more time with the llamas, so that was nice.
So the plan changes ended up being a good thing?
Yes, definitely.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.
Thank you. That was really lovely. Before we get into prayer, I just want to let you know that our congregation has suffered two deaths this week, Joan and Evie. And it is far worse for their families and friends, especially during this time. So please keep them in your prayers. And while there are numerous public figures who have passed on, I particularly want to mention John Lewis, who has been a friend and a mentor to Derek Kilmer for many years. And he's a public figure by which hundreds of thousands of people have found courage. Representative John Lewis lived an incredible life of service and love, keeping the faith in the hardest times. I pray that his courage and tenacity will continue to seed and then grow in the hearts of a whole new wave of people who desire liberty and justice for all. So we're going to sing and pray together today. And this is an old melody with really difficult words. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. You got it? So let's sing. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Let's sing that again. God who raises us up, the one who lifts us gently into joy, who walks beside us, even when we hear the worst news we could possibly receive. You, O God, are with us when we remember those things that reduced us to a heap on the floor. And you are the one who leads us to find a hand that will help guide us up again. We give thanks for your breath of life, for your promise of comfort, for your love that refuses to give up. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Oh God, you lift us up so that we might be your people, the ones who love and laugh. You lift us up so that we might challenge the powers that be, that we might have the courage to stand up to systems that betray and hold people down from becoming all that you created them to be. You lift us up so that we might shine like the sun, taking the gifts that we have and breaking them out of the darkness and into the world. Help us, O God, to be your people, to care for the lost and the lonely and the hurting. Help us, O God, to be your comfort to those who are grieving this day, to be food for the hungry, to be strength for the weary. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Hi, I'm Anna. I hope everyone's doing well during COVID. Hear these words from Proverbs, the Book of Wisdom. A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. The tongue of the wise dispenses knowledge, but the mouths of fools pour out folly. The eyes of the Lord are in every place, keeping watch on the evil and the good. A gentle tongue is a tree of life, but perverseness in it breaks the spirit. The fear of the Lord is instruction in wisdom, and humility goes before honor. This is the word of life.
Thanks be to God. Are there any coffee drinkers out there? Yes. So what happens when you want to make yourself a cup of coffee, but you open the cupboard and there is no coffee? Do you get frustrated and angry? What about when your partner or your children say or do things that you don't like? Or how about when you make a plan and you carefully communicate it and no one is ready on time? It's frightening how easily anger and rage just come flying out of us. Anger comes out as a reaction to feelings of dissatisfaction, frustration, unhappiness. It appears when we are unable to fulfill our wishes and desires, or when we feel forced to do something that we dislike or would normally avoid. But it also comes on more quickly when we are under stress. And Lord knows, we are in stressful times right now with no end in sight. We just heard a few verses from the book of Proverbs. Proverbs is part of the Bible that we call wisdom literature. Job and Ecclesiastes are also in that same genre. They are not based on God's revelation per se, but more on human understanding and learning over time as people strive to follow God. As part of God's holy book, Proverbs arose from men and women watching the way that the world works and then gleaning the wisdom they wish to pass on. The wisdom contained in the book of Proverbs is wisdom believed to help us live out a life based on God's values, or what people believe to be God's values at the time it was written. It is part of Judeo-Christian history, and these words are from faithful people through the ages, passing on what they observe to be true. So this collection of Proverbs that Anna just read today are about our words, our tongue, as it is often referred to in the Bible. More specifically, they have to do with our verbal reactions that can cause strife between people. Now, it is impossible to go through life without offending someone. Most of us do not communicate in the same ways, but we make assumptions that we do. And when we do that, misunderstandings take place and the hurt sets in quickly. Our instincts are to meet an angry, harsh word with more angry, harsh words, and we escalate the conflict. Now, because we've been hurt, whether it's intended or not, we retaliate. But other times, we aren't retaliating. We are the instigators. Like when there is no more coffee because we used it up yesterday. But when someone walks in the kitchen, suddenly we're blaming them and we're angry that their presence is even in the room with us. Proverbs tells us that a gentle answer is the way to go. Soft language is not weak language. Soft answers are the way we talk and reason when we aren't raging inside. It has a spirit and a tone that invites dialogue rather than a fight. We are probably not reminded often enough that sometimes it is more important to be loving than to be right. And if we are loving and caring, we might gain the ear of our antagonist. What we do know is that anger can die out from a lack of fuel. It can be won over by graciousness. And according to these scriptures, it is better to win by kindness than to crush by cruelty. Now, even that sounds like manipulation to me, like you're still looking for a winner and a loser. But what if it is actually a win-win situation. Now, responding with a soft word rather than angry words doesn't mean that you stuff the anger deep down so that the rage is just seething inside. No. Instead, it means that you recognize your anger in the moment, and then you channel it in a constructive way, and then you're ready to respond with kindness. Perhaps that is how it becomes a win-win for everyone involved. And that, my friends, that sounds like gospel good news. It's so much easier said than done. I know this. And especially right now during a pandemic when we are told to cancel our plans, stay home, and make way too many decisions about what is safe and not safe, what we should and should not do, it is getting really hard. I've been reading quite a few articles on research about how people are dealing with the pandemic and what that does to our spiritual and mental well-being. These times are really tough. Humans are created with a need for connection, with a need for touch and for interaction. Even the most introverted among us need other humans to thrive. So when we are not getting enough interaction, our stress levels rise and our sense of balance just declines. Less physical activity also contributes to more stress and less ability to control reactions. You ever heard of being hangry? So hungry that you become angry and can barely think straight? Well, lack of social connection is like that too. Being starved for social connection can leave you irritable, less able to vocal your concerns very well. In this time, we are prone to anxiety and depression, sadness, frustration, and anger that feels disconnected even from the source. Uncomfortable emotions, all of this. For many of us, these things lead to lashing out. Pandemic is a thing that is happening to us, and that heightens our feelings of being out of control, which leads directly into these knee-jerk reactions rather than calculated responses that have an opportunity for kindness. For some, I think it's really easy to just want to retreat or to think that even more isolation is the solution because we think, well, if we're not around people, well, then I can't hurt them. Well, that's not a good solution either. In fact, the Bible teaches us that silence in the face of evil is not good. And while our household irritations are rarely about bold-faced evil, silence and walking away and stuffing it down deep inside is only going to produce a volcano of reactions later on. And that will be experienced as evil by the people around you. So one twist is that sometimes we take these passages and we insist on speaking truth, right? But we say that's also a biblical mandate. Speaking truth is important. But if speaking truth is not spoken with love, it is often received as evil, ill will, or harshness that only breaks down our relationships and adds to the fire. It is often disguised as sarcasm, and it only adds to festering feelings of hurt by those who receive it. Our scripture today reminds us that soft words are truly a way forward. Unexpected kind words take people by surprise. They give life. Unexpected kind words, soft words, make people pay attention. Soft words in the face of anger usually come after we have made the choice to be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. You know, we have a handful of school principals in our congregation, some retired now, but they will all tell you that it takes two to fight. They know this truth, and when a fight ensues on their school property, they use it to find both offenders. They also know that many fights could be avoided if either party were to stop fighting and show kindness or just walk away. So how do we do this for real? So I took these steps that I'm going to show you from the Mayo Clinic, okay? So number one, they say, think before you speak. Take a few moments to collect your thoughts before saying anything. Allow others involved in the situation to do the same. Sometimes that's where we get hung up. Once you're calm, express your anger. As soon as you're thinking clearly, then express your frustration in an assertive but non-confrontational way. State your concerns and your needs clearly and directly, without hurting others or trying to control them. Many of us need to stop the anger in its tracks before it gets destructive. We can't even think straight until we jolt ourselves out of the cycle. And so maybe try these next things. So number three is you need to actually take a time out. Get some exercise. Walk around the block. Run down the street and back. Drink some water. That's one of the suggestions. It actually calms the body's responses. Try counting from 1 to 10. Take 3 deep breaths while looking away from the source of your anger. These things help interrupt the rage that is inside, and it can help us begin to think more clearly. Identify possible solutions and try to let go of those things that you can't solve. Instead of focusing on what made you mad, work at resolving the issue at hand. You know, does your child's messy room just drive you crazy? Close the door. Is your partner late for dinner every night? I don't know. Scheduled like meals later in the evening? That doesn't always work. Maybe you agree to eat on your own a few times a week, if that could let some of that go. Remind yourself that anger won't fix anything. It might only make it worse, but we have to do something with it, right? Number 6 is to stick with those I statements. These are so hard to learn sometimes. But I statements help us to avoid criticizing or placing blame, which certainly just increases tension. We use I statements to describe the problem. We're respectful, specific. For example, you can say, I'm upset that you left the table without offering to help with the dishes, instead of, you never do any housework at all. You always leave the dishes on the table, right? That is just a harsh word that invites more harsh words. If practiced, I statements are soft words. They don't shy away from the issue, but they do make room for a way forward. That first response is so important. You know, later we have to work on forgiveness and using humor, perhaps, to release the tension in the room. We can practice relaxation skills. We can even seek professional help. These are the long-term solutions that are really important when we are stuck in cycles of anger and rage that just continue to break down our relationships. But I think Proverbs is talking about a basic principle of reaction versus response. And this is something that we can become aware of and work on, especially during this time of pandemic. Awareness of our behavior truly can lead to better behavior. It helps us predict what might happen so that we can avoid some of those situations altogether. Of course, in theory, it sounds easy enough, but we know that it is much harder in practice. But this is a good time to work on that. Speaking a gentle word when I'm seething with rage. Speaking a gentle word when all I feel from other people is attack. Speaking a gentle word when I'm trying to live in a loving way and then it's not returned back to me. This is not the easy path. But I've had enough of experience to know that when such a word is spoken, when we do succeed in de-escalating a volatile situation, it is like a healing ointment for a wound. It's like a word of God that you know was meant just for you. You know, anger so often prevents us from hearing others, and it makes us jump to conclusions and we assume the worst. In my first year of teaching, I had a pair of students that seemed to do everything they possibly could to make it look like they were ignoring me. It drove me nuts. When I'd given instructions, they'd whisper together. When I sang their part for them, they would roll their eyes. When I would wear a new suit, they'd make fun of it in front of everybody. I worked so hard to keep my cool, but it was really difficult. There were times when I sent them out of the room because I just couldn't take it anymore and focus on what I needed to be doing. Now, one of those days, I was at the end of my rope, but something inside of me, I like to believe that it was the spirit, kept making me take a deep breath. And instead, I was able to focus the class elsewhere when it happened again and again. Well, later that day, at the end of school, the school counselor came to tell me that one of those girls that morning had witnessed their father being arrested. in the midst of a domestic violence call. And I did a lot of reflection on that. Kicking her out of class that day would have helped no one. It likely would have prevented the trust that was able to later develop between them and me as time went on. You know, I imagine that many of us, if not every one of us, has a story that's somewhat like this one, that only in hindsight can we see that our refusal to react with anger opened up possibilities that otherwise would have just been shut down and forever gone. May God give us all the strength to be faithful in these times. It is gospel good news to offer a soft word. Amen. There are two important words that we must learn as we seek to do better with our words, even as we sometimes fail. And those two words are, I'm sorry. My friends, anger is going to get the best of us. But the good news of God, maybe even the best news of all, is that forgiveness is offered and it is granted by the one who loves us and loves the ones that we hurt more than we ever can. The God we love, the Christ that we follow, leads us on the road to perfect love. This road is anything but flat and straight and easy, but God is with us every step of the way. So go with God to love and serve the world, the ones that you love, and even the ones who make you really, really angry. Amen.
To those living on the margins, there is room at the table for everyone. This is where it all begins. This is how we gather in. There is room at the table for everyone. Too long we have wandered, burdened and undone. There is room at the table. just living on the margins. There is room at the table for everyone. This is where it all begins. This is how we gather.
All the people sit.
Amen.